This is a bad time to bring up that I'm afraid of heights.
I'm going to show you the spot where investigators are looking at very closely right now. There, on that front wall, near the newspaper dispensers, there are at least more than half a dozen bullet holes in the wall. Plastics, aluminum, paper, and cardboard. And even something as little as this is actually quite heavy.
It's too much of this, that's blockage, that's flooding.
Firefighters from Start, Hollywood, Rayville, and Delhi all responded to the scene as both of those trucks nearing the end of the line caught fire. There's still plenty of debris littering the sidewalks out here, and you can see a large rut in the ground where one of those vehicles drove over and actually crashed into this sign. West Monroe police say a vehicle that was carrying a mother and her four children was plowed into head-on by a pickup truck when it crossed the center line and into them. All of them wound up injured, including the truck driver, and new details by West Monroe police say he was intoxicated. This was the scene on Cypress Street in West Monroe Monday night. Sirens blazing, wreckage in the streets, injured children. West Monroe police say a pickup truck drove down the street, crossed the middle line, and plowed head-on into a vehicle carrying a mother and four children. New details are now coming to light.
Once on scene, it was determined that the driver of the at-fault vehicle was impaired.
The accused drunk driver is 44-year-old Ricky O'Brien of Start. His arrest report reads an open Bud Light can was found between his feet in the truck, and he admitted to officers he'd had several beers along with oxycodone. O'Brien, the mother, and all four children were taken to the hospital. After treatment, O'Brien went somewhere else.
He was booked into the West Monroe Correctional Center, where he was booked for DWI 4th, careless operation, as well as cited for open container of an alcoholic beverage inside of his motor vehicle.
After declaring a state of emergency, Governor Bobby Jindal flew into Ouachita Parish Tuesday to see the damage from Monday's storm for himself.
You've got to feel so bad for folks that have got trees in their homes. You've got folks that don't have power. You've got people that lost their cars. Most important thing is I'm grateful there was no loss of life.
In Monroe alone, 200 to 300 homes were damaged, with more than 30,000 people in the Twin Cities losing power. At the Ouachita Parish Fire Department, Governor Jindal met with dozens of local lawmakers, city leaders, and law enforcement agencies to coordinate a recovery effort.
Entergy told us today at the parish OEP, they said the latest people would have their power back on would be by Friday, but they hope to be able to give people a better sense later today. We made available to them National Guard as well as DOTD, earth movers, equipment, people, anything we can do to help with debris removal.
As Jindal walked through the damage in Monroe's Garden District, he said that teams from Homeland Security, State Police, and even FEMA are coming. The governor's visit was a surprise to some residents.
It was different. I've never talked to the governor before. I think that's good that he's trying to help us after this bad storm.
That means that he cares for all the cities, because this city's kind of small.
Bob Sale, whose gift and camera store in Monroe was slashed by a tree, says any show of state support is needed.
It's a shame this one would gotta happen to get them all here at one time like this, but I appreciate them coming up and just giving us a little support.
Jindal says he wants people to remain safe, promising the state is in this for the long haul.
So many injuries happen because of down power lines, because of accidents with chainsaws, because of expired food products. It's so important. Most injuries happen after a storm, not during a storm. And I'm grateful we've got such a resilient people. They've been through this before, and what's great is to see neighbors helping neighbors.
Take a minute and think about your arms and hands. They help us drive. They help us eat. They help us keep up at work and stay connected to the world. But just imagine living your life without them.
Well, no blood. We did okay.
For Tullis native Bill Bradford, that's been his reality every day since 1986, the day he was working on a building in Winfield, holding a piece of rebar in his hands when a transformer arced out.
And it arced out and hit that piece of rebar. And it went in my arms, and I had a set of keys in my pocket and blowed out the exit wound with my leg.
Bradford remembers every moment of the shock.
I thought my back was going to break because, you know, your muscles contract so tight.
Then the transformer blew. He fell off the building, and Bradford says that saved his life.
I was dead when I left the top of the building. And when I hit the ground, my nose and my toes hit at the same time, and it was enough compression to get my heart going.
Bradford was a 29-year-old man who knew his loss the moment he hit the ground.
My arms was up in front of me, and I knew I was going to lose them.
Now, 28 years, 25 surgeries, and two prosthetic arms later, Bill wakes up, pours two cups of coffee grounds in the machine, and fires up the griddle.
What you think?
That's delicious.
You got to get that right angle. Some tasks take a lot longer. Practice, 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 I guess you'd say.
He plays with his dogs Coco and Jackie across the field of his Calhoun home.
She's been the ball chaser ever since.
Then he gets in his car and drives, something he's learned to do again. He even volunteered driving a food bank truck for a couple years.
I really enjoyed that. Go to all the different Walmarts and Sam's and stuff like that, pick up whatever food they was donating to go to the food bank.
What's been one of the things you've missed most?
Shooting.
Shooting.
Now the former Marine says he tries to help wherever he can. He's worked with the Percy R. Johnson Byrne Foundation for 7 years and was a prison evangelist for 11.
Faith in the Lord Jesus Christ is my main thing.
He also served as a certified peer visitor for Amputee Empowerment Partners based in Oklahoma City, counseling burn victims and amputees, adult and child alike.
There is life after amputation. I mean, you know, they can still live a full, productive life if they want to. Yes, there's going to be limitations with their life, but usually we all live with limitations anyway.
Bill says he's relearned to do everything he used to do with arms to send the message to never give up, no matter what. And if a story can be told from the life of one man, it's a story of perseverance, a story of hope.
Just continue on. You might not make a mile in progress in one day, but you might make a few inches. Inches is all it takes. Not too bad, huh?
Nick Lawton, Fox 14 News.